Welcome back, everyone, to Seed Story Cup 4. We're going to be moving on to the second match of the day. After the first team kill that we had, you know, between the members of Archon, we're going to have another one later, but this is not yet. We've got another match before. We're going to be getting Stensivka versus Vortex for the next match. Now, before we move on, I want to remind you that we're doing a raffle on Facebook, so you can check it out. It's the Take TV raffle. It's happening at facebook.com/TakeTV. We're going to be giving away chairs, swag, and some Hearthstone packs. So as you can see here, you just go on facebook.com/TakeTV, and you have a chance to get one of these cool chairs, which, by the way, is very comfortable, I can confirm. I've been sitting in them pretty much all weekend long. And Hearthstone packs to get yourself some cool cards and a swag to resemble this amazing, handsome guy. It's an ultra hoodie. It's not just any hoodie. So you just have to put in your name, your country, your email address, and you'll be contacted to get any of that stuff. Again, just go here. Don't forget to click on the Seed Story Cup 4 raffle just to make sure you get on the right page, and you'll be good to go. Right. Well,
awesome.
Yeah.
All right. So, you guys watched the first match?
Yes.
A lot of esports in that last game.
Yeah, it was quite a lot. Well, what can you do with three shredders on the board? There has to come something out of it, Risky. But here now we go into another series, Vortex against Sivka. And I'm actually pretty hyped for this. Sivka, I practice actually a lot with him, and well, Vortex is also Dutch, so I also want to root for him, but I, yeah.
Now, Stensivka is one of those players. I mean, I like the fact that he's bringing Control Warrior a lot, and he's play. I don't know if you've noticed, but he plays it very grittily, right?
Yeah, I noticed that in the first group stage.
Yeah, he's very slow, right? He takes it slower than Life Coach. Like he's going to develop weapons a lot later, and he won't mind taking a lot of damage.
Yeah, and his decks is always so ticked, or it's sometimes so strange. They have like double Brawl and double BGH, and you're like, yeah, whoa. Like it's just supposed to deal with everything, kinda. Like it has insane amount of removal and doesn't even have that many threats. I know he sometimes even discuss to not play Dr. Boom, and sometimes it has no Alex. Like it's always really interesting how Sivka makes his warrior deck. And actually what did we saw for Ben here is the warrior is getting banned from Vortex, and we see Paladin ban for Sivka.
Yeah, again, this is a best of seven, so there's going to be a little, you're going to see an extra deck from each of these players, as opposed to the stages that we had with five decks yesterday. It's going to be seven this time. Now, based on the lineups, I can't really say that anybody has a massive edge, but the mage being present on Stensivka's side is kind of the strange thing. There's no druid for him, whereas Vortex decided to bring one.
I find this actually super interesting that Sivka is banning the warrior here, because I know that yesterday he played Handlock, and now I still see the. It feels like it's like one of the matchups you want, and
maybe against Priest he's happy to play Handlock.
And now he has like Priest, and maybe he just changed his whole lineup also. But like, why do you really is banning warrior?
Yeah, but he couldn't change his whole lineup, right? He could just add one extra.
Oh, okay, call this okay. Yeah, yeah, but well, Warrior is always like super scary now. I feel like Warrior and Paladin are the two classes that like almost take all the bans here.
Yeah, I totally agree. Like I've seen like so many people ban Paladin, and Warrior probably the second most banned class.
Yeah, Paladin, the thing is that those who didn't ban it seems like they got punished sometimes for it. Like it seems like it's been it's kind of the class and the deck that you expect to be beatable, but somehow, just somehow, they win. It's like when you get a win, it's still a very close call.
Okay, so actually Vortex had kind of a slow start, had the Wild Growth, but shapeshifted two turns, so it gave Sivka a lot of time. And now we see the Emperor being played on curve, and giving a bit of a cheaper hand here. It's still getting the combo cheaper is some of the cards that you really want to get cheaper. Getting a lore for 6 mana when you want to play it anyways at turn 7 doesn't really help, but
It doesn't accelerate your curve yet. If anything though, it's nice to have that double combo just because the second Savage Roar can always be gotten later, where you can get the 22 damage burst. And if you have even just a shade on the board, that's going to add you an extra 4 damage from the roars and the basic shade size.
Yeah, it's like the super biggest, like since Patron, like the biggest burst you can get actually.
Right. I mean, it's always been around, but nowadays it's you don't need double combo against many classes, but against Warrior it feels like it's almost a necessity very often, because nowadays Warriors have, especially ones that are a bit like Stensivka, because they just armor up for days.
Yeah, or tank up.
Right, tank up. They just tank up.
That one is even more frustrating for me.
It's annoying, especially when you're this close to winning and then somehow you're always 2 damage off lethal, and you know that's because Justicar gave them an extra 2 health on that one turn. Yeah, it adds up.
Okay, so a lot of cards here. Sivka really having more the cheaper cards and a lot of removal from the starting hand. And yeah, Portik is kind of see what he can draw out of this. And still a 5-drop that he can drop here after killing off this Cruel Taskmaster. And he's looking into the death spot, so it's kind of awkward for him to leave the Taskmaster up that just will trade into something together with the death spot.
Yeah, I was going to ask you, do you think it would be maybe better to get to attack and charge with the 4-4 and force the warrior to take 8 damage from this? Since you're not going to win a very long game anyway, and getting that extra bit of damage for a crazy combo turn, would that be better? Or is going for taunt and forcing him to use executes, Cruel Tasks, and Shield Slams early better?
I mean, it depends. It's a read. Like, if you think he has a way to remove the last point of damage from the Root of Claw, then charging is obviously better. Like, otherwise, I would say taunting is better. Because you can use extra removal, like maybe a Shield Slam, even you can bait stuff out.
Yeah, it's really questionable. I mean, I don't think you are in a spot where you can already raise with Boreas.
Course,
seeing it like 30 live, it feels a bit, and it just dies for free, and then there comes a boom or a big drop, and it feels kind of awkward. And it's a bit questionable, and Sivka actually has a really good turn here by drawing 2 cards by attacking and just playing the Cruel Taskmaster to kill off the Druid of the Claw. And yeah, like the board, it looks kind of weak, but with double Acolyte, that are the minions that the warrior wants in the early mid game.
Yeah, I mean, this is pretty much what's going to get him through the big threats. In Wheel Stone, Sivka tends to play decks that don't have that many, you know, massive threats. He does have the classic Rom, but sometimes you don't even see Alexstrasza in some of his decks. He's just going to attack for a lot of removal and try to drag the game onto fatigue if he has to, because he knows that's a game he wins just about every time.
Yeah, so there is an innervate draw now. Not sure if that is really changing much here for Vortex. It's just looking at some... like, the board is kind of weak, but it's super annoying to play something here into it.
I mean, that's one of the strengths, I guess, of Warrior against Druid is they have minions that are annoying to remove, no matter what it is, whether it's Belcher or Acolyte of Pain that you have to keep her and then wait to kill. At every step, something is just going to frustrate you as a Druid.
There was also the option actually to overdraw here. You put a lot of resources into that. I don't think it's really worth it to burn a card.
Yeah.
But it was possible. You called Rep for 1 and swipe the Cruel Taskmaster and Hero Point, and it will be an overdraw of 2 cards. So, but
yeah, I mean,
this is not a matchup that goes to fatigue really often.
And if it does, do you win it, right? That's the big question.
2 cards, it can be a lot.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's still really questionable.
Like, it could be key cards like a Brawl or Alex key cards.
Yeah, if you remove one of the key cards, like another Shield Slam as well would be great to see go, because that means that your board is likely to stick a bit more. And you know that Stan Sivka's had a crazy tendency to play double Brawl. So if you can remove at least one of those, then that's safety that after the first one, you're going to be okay.
Yeah, this Sylvanas, it is kind of annoying, but I mean, Sivka can just tray all his minions into it and deal with it pretty efficiently and just look for what the best drop is that he can play here. And looks like a Belcher's pretty decent here, kind of on curve.
That is a sick turn for Stan Sivka. I mean, he's got a full hand against a Druid who doesn't even have a board, and he's still at 30 health. So the Druid's going to have to develop something absolutely insane that Stan Sivka can't answer. When the double Brawl execute, it looks to me like it's going to be very tough for Vortex to even think about going through at this point.
The point that he gained so much time, like Vortex, he had the Wild Grove, and that is like the card you look for, but if you don't have a 4-drop and not even having a 5-drop, what can you do? It's just a lot of time that you get to, like 3 turns for the warrior is a lot. Yeah. Another interesting thing is actually both players having Priest. Both players having Priest in their lineups. I didn't really saw much Priest here at all, and now 2 people playing Priest.
Yeah, I know Vortex had his Priest banned the first time he played. I forget who his opponent was, but the Priest was banned outright because it's not a class you expect, and so you don't build a lineup around it, and it's going to take you off guard if you're trying to get something done with Secret Paladin, for instance, or even Druid nowadays isn't always able to remove that 2-4 and then the curve into like a Valence Chosen, and everything just keeps snowballing out of control.
Yeah, Priest is really good.
I agree.
Ty's knew it early.
I was like, I always never called make it work, Priest. I was like, I hated the class because it was so reactive all the time. And now I finally found some love with like the Dragon Priest that is more consistent. It plays more its own game. You play more in tempo game. I actually really like it, and I think it's really strong in the more aggro to mid-range meta.
Yeah. Oh, it's not sensitive code, the tempo mage, so of course, if you're playing something like Priest, you should be able to, if you're able to, you know, weather down some of the early game aggression, you're likely going to be fine.
Yeah, and we see here actually the double brawl, there it is, and it's really strong. At this moment, it feels like a card that is not going to do much with being ahead or even on board, but it might really help in the future.
Wait. So he's got... No, he needs 13 mana to pull this off. I was going to say, can he ever get the Force of Nature, Innervate, Force of Nature, Savage Roar, but he can't. He's going to be one Innervate off, so he'd need at least an extra coin, which he doesn't have. I mean, I guess one combo now is as good as you're going to get because you have two minions already on board.
Yeah, it looks kind of...
It's a lot of damage, though. Don't you think so? I mean, just think about it. You know, like Force of Nature, Savage Roar, Swipe. How much damage is that? That's a lot of damage.
That's a lot of damage with two minions.
Could that be lethal? I didn't even calculate. We're looking at 20, 24. He was one off lethal.
Oh, wow.
He was one off.
Wow.
Belcher MVP. And now with the Force of Nature with the Swipe follow-up, I feel like he's going to be in a great spot if he's able to just push through that little bit of extra damage. If that shape lives. And the odds are really slim. But
there was no option to swipe there with a hero power. It was, how much mana was the shade?
The shade was 3. You could have used the swipe with the... The thing is, you have to use your hero power to kill the slime.
Yeah,
so hero power.
There was no efficient way to deal the 2 damage.
No, unfortunately.
Yeah, that was the thing.
That's the only reason why... Uh-oh.
Oh, wow.
You would like to say this is going to be... Mm-hmm. It's all going to be okay, Stan, but I can't promise. Yeah, sorry.
Oh, and that kill is actually pretty big here.
Yeah. I think Vortex, after... I have no doubt that Stan Sivko will shield block. At least, I assume so. Knowing Stan, anything's possible.
Yeah, you have to... I just would like to play the Belcher with the shield block here. You saw him super aggressive turn from the Vortex where he kind of went all in by saying, yeah, I need to just go now, otherwise it's over for me. And he decides to play the Belcher, for sure nice.
All right, so there's the other Force of Nature. He's got it already. He can find the other Savage Roar. He does pick up a Lothab Aspirant. The thing is, Lothab Aspirant turn, he can play those two if he wants. Because you can kill the Armorsmith and deny extra armor.
But why for an Armorsmith? I mean, it's not really...
Well, here's what it does. You're giving your opponent 4 health, I mean 3 health from the swipe, I guess. Well, that also kind of works. Because you're removing 1 and you're giving 1. It's just that the Armorsmith is now stacking more armor than the swipe could remove.
Is he going to Force of Nature here and going to play the value game even more?
I don't think you can at this point. I think you're the aggressor, you have to go face him.
Yeah.
Yeah, force the warrior to respond. Oh, great guard here for Stan Sivka. Yeah, he uses his hero power a lot. Values that GG button.
So what Sivka just has to do now is just make the right play to play around the combo. That, like, it's the only thing you can die to with 3 cards left. Even it's like the 3 best minions from the druid being left, that should still not be enough. And just make sure that the combo, that you're out of the reach of the Force of Nature Savage Roar combo, the second one.
Yeah,
and you don't have to play around an insane combo anymore because you saw already one combo being gone and has to feel a bit safer too.
Yeah, the only thing that can come is 14 damage, that's it.
And this is for Vortex, kind of looking pretty awkward now.
You've got to trade your minions into that Grom just to get rid of it. But there's no way it feels any good.
If he can actually deal with this board, I mean, there is not that much left for Sivka at all. With like double brawl, double execute, it's so much removal. If the warrior is able to just play, if it doesn't get his threats, maybe there's still a way. Toyda is actually leaving the cast now for a second. Might come back. We will see. But
yeah, I know he had a fit of cough, right?
Yeah,
couldn't stop it. I guess the throat is itchy. Well, diseases are running around. There's like a billion people in this place.
Yeah. One and of we can do it spread. Together also, Noxious.
Yes. I love you, Thais.
Yeah.
Marry me. If I wasn't married, I'd give you a shot.
Oh, wow.
All right, so you BGH your own boom for BM.
Oh, are we really going to that space already? It's the first game. Come on, you can do that maybe later.
Well, Vortex might be tilted. Mm-hmm. Do you think so? Is it worth it? Is the tilt factor... Because the thing is, Tensefka is a very well-mannered man. Mm-hmm. I doubt he would go for something like this, just knowing him.
Yeah. Especially after yesterday, like, Wreckful. I mean, just saying Wreckful, you can just go again. Yeah.
Would you like a rematch? Also, I'm going to kill my own Dr. Boo.
Yeah. And, well, Ezra Drake picking up. I don't know if there's anything that can do wonders with this Ezra Drake. And third swipe will be decent, but
yeah,
didn't pick it up.
Yeah, I don't think he's a very good druid player when you can't pick up your third swipe on command. And using their last force of nature to kill Dr. Boom with the Armor Smith, I think at this point Vortex knows the game is lost. What he's hoping for is maybe to glean a bit more information about Stansifka's deck in case Stansifka decides to show more.
Yeah.
But he just concedes, alright.
I mean, there was nothing left for Vortex. Right. You can play it and hope there is not one damage and you're going to see one other card maybe, but... Yeah, there was nothing left that Vortex called comeback in the series. And actually, taking it with the Warrior against the Druids, it's in a pretty kind of even matchup, people say now, but it was in the past really favored for Druids. But
yeah, it's actually changed a lot, and I feel like the way Stansifka builds his decks, he's always favored against them, just because he's playing such a removal-heavy deck. Like, it's always very heavy on the removal, to the point where you're not really looking to ever play something crazy like a tempo play like Alexstrasza, because usually against a druid, Alexstrasza is mostly useless. But getting that extra ball, getting maybe an extra slam in that warrior deck, you're able to remove some of the early threats from the opponents. Whether it's Secret Paladin or druid, you can start damaging stuff like Aspirant, finish it off with Cruel Task. A lot of things can like really change the matchup.
Actually, interesting here, Vortex going with the Paladin, and we see here nothing. Really aggressive Paladin, it might still be, but it really looks like a mid-range Paladin, maybe still a secret Paladin.
It could be, yeah.
I mean, Belcher, Boom, Boom is going to be played in every Paladin version, so doesn't say much, but it. I would say with the equality, like there are some techs sometimes, but I would say this might just be a mid-range Paladin, and mid-range Paladin considered being one of the better decks that can handle the Warrior. And the reason for that is actually the hero power. Paladin hero power is not considered the best hero power, but into the Warrior hero power, it's really good. The Warrior has a really hard time dealing with all the 1-1s that are spawning.
Yeah, it's one of those things where the Brawl, like the double Brawl from Stansifka, will give him at least 2 turns of respite. Like the ability to clean up a bunch of 1-1s and whatever's left over, you know, for as far as big minions go. But you know, he's playing the Owl as well, so that's giving him the extra Tyrion removal, which very often, unless you're playing Harrison Jones, you're not able to deal with that. So in this case, he's going to be able to maybe Ironbeak Owl it much later in the game and get himself a bit more. But just based on the lay on hands, I think Vortex is obviously playing mid-range.
Yeah, and well, Stifka dealing a bit here with an... More late game hand, not a really good opener. The things you want in your opening hand are normally the weapons. You don't mind the early drops like an Armorsmith, Acolyte. They just trade so well into all these kind of weak health minions from the Paladin. And but yeah, the double Brawl, I mean, that's probably going to do some work really good into the Paladin too.
Yeah.
Not now, but I'm pretty sure that it's going to get decent value later in the game.
Yeah, and right now Stansifka doesn't know whether this is mid-range or whether this is something like a kind of a mid-range secret Pally. Yeah. It might be secret as far as Stansifka knows. So right now what he's thinking probably is, I can kill the Zombie Chow, and then if a Blessing of Kings comes out on that 1-1, I can use the Owl on it. And keep myself in this game. So there's definitely an option here where he just ends up going and kills the Chow, even though the Cruel Task dies to the weapon.
Yeah, I would say Stifka probably knows actually what Vortex should play now. I mean, there is a series being played. I don't know if Vortex showed this Paladin or
I think he might have shown it once. Yeah.
So Stifka might have an idea, but Vortex, he went 2-0 in the group, and it might just be that Paladin gets banned one, then the other series you didn't have to play it, and then it's really hard to make the guess.
Yeah, Vortex here holding on to the charges on the Coghammer, realizes that he probably will need it to clean up a Belcher's Slime if that comes out, or combine it with some of his minions at the moment.
And that is the hard thing for the Warrior. I mean, you have like all these minions that are so annoying, but not really worth your removal and not efficient clearable.
Yeah.
It's super hard for the warrior to deal with these minions. And yeah, one of the cards that normally has to really carry the warrior in this matchup is the Brawl.
Yeah, which is exactly like you saw him develop the weapon, and Vortex knows what that means. Obviously, it's like, oh, he plays a weapon, doesn't even attack. I know what's coming. So he's absolutely certain that the Brawl will come out. And I think at this point, Stensivka's getting as good a Brawl as he'll get for a while.
I mean, what did Sivka play all game? Nothing. He only armored up, and now he played the X, didn't even attack with the X. And you know what Sivka plays? He loves to play double Brawl. So yeah, pretty reasonable that Vortex expects you to run.
Right.
He's just saving a Belcher with it, so pretty well played there.
Yeah, because the only thing you'd keep is the slime plus whatever, you know, minion stays behind it. So at best, you'd be able to protect a 1-1 or maybe a mini bot if it lives, but it's not necessarily worth too much to overextend here. All right. So, I mean, there is a Dr. Boom coming up for Vortex next turn, and Stensivka is sorely lacking in BGH, executes, shield blocks, shield slams. He's got very little to deal with that Dr. Boom.
That's actually a pretty decent draw here. Together with the Shield Maiden, makes it possible to kill the Belcher if you want here, together with the coin.
Right. I feel like that might be your best option, setting up a 5-5. That doesn't die to True Silver.
Yeah, and you can even clear off the slime with your War Axe, and it looks like really good. It's a really powerful turn, actually, where you just, for 7 mana, you're able to play a decent minion, get armor, and just heaven removal.
So, I mean, there's no like that your follow-up on 7, though, if you're Stensivka is going to be kind of the typical control warrior, you know, the wait, you know, wait and pass. I have no time. On 7. Oh, he's gonna go for the Sylvana, so okay. He's guaranteed a slime at the very least, assuming the Belcher trades here with the weapon. And I think Vortex is going to be happy just because he's got Boom on the back end.
Yeah, Vortex just being able to deal with Sylvanas with just giving a slime. I don't know if he has good answers for Sylvanas, but it's like just giving him a slime can never be super bad. Yeah.
It feels a little bad because Execute might be enabled by that one slime. Like the Execute alone makes this slime absolutely, like, it's a big threat because you're basically killing your own 7-7 by giving that one attack minion to your opponent. But right now, Stensivka does not have the execute.
Yeah, and this is, I guess, I'm not sure if Sivka plays double BGH anymore. I know he played it at Starlander and the value that he had from it was super low. I don't even know if he did anything else than playing tempo BGHs.
Yeah, I like this play though from Stensivka. Just trying to get card draw from the Acolyte perhaps. I would have maybe considered using Cruel Task on it. You know, attacking with the slime into Dr. Boom, then Cruel Tasking my Acolyte. Maybe that way I'm able to find an execute, maybe a BGH and coin it out.
Oh wow, these Boom Boys are pretty mean here.
Find the BGH, find the execute. Although right now execute is going to be
and
quite...
And there is the execute.
Oh
right
my
after,
god!
Right after you play the Cruel Taskmaster on your own Acolyte. So no enabler anymore.
Yeah, I think Stensivka attacking with the slime into Dr. Boom might have been safer. Because you're enabling it. Then you play Acolyte, Cruel Task, draw a card. If it's BGH or execute, you're in a good spot.
Oh, and a Consecration draw. Is that even...
Oh, my.
No, it's a lot of damage getting in here.
It is 3 off.
Oh, wow. This is going pretty fast all of a sudden.
Good thing Shield Maiden, Armor Up, Shield Slam will take care of Boom, because otherwise I think Stensivka would be on his last leg at this point.
Yeah, it's that coin here actually doing a lot of work.
Wow, well, double execute,
Didn't he have like 0 removal 1 turn ago, and now he has like all the 4 removal cards here in his hand?
Yeah, double shield slam, double execute.
It's sometimes you have nothing, sometimes you have everything.
Feels like my druid early game.
Or drawing the wild growths at the most awkward moments, right?
It's like, alright, so I'm on turn 9, and what do I want to draw right now? Wild growth, obviously. There's no Quartermaster from Vortex, though. I know he is playing, I think, a double Quartermaster version of Midrange Pally, if I'm not mistaken. Right now, though, he doesn't have those. They're really strong against Warrior once you've seen a Brawl, but he hasn't been able to pick those up.
And Mestra Battle is just a super annoying card to deal with Foreign Controller. Normally, like, Patron Warriors have these play with Wind Effects, have also Ghoul, and now without having the Despite on board, these 1-1s are pretty annoying, and I'm pretty sure Sivka should be a bit afraid of a Quartermaster at this moment. But what can you do about it? I mean, it's just super hard to deal with.
So, would you ever consider No, I mean, it's kind of clunky not to use, I mean, to use a brawl on a board like this. It's not necessarily a good brawl. That doesn't really improve his hand quality. What it does, though, is it does give him the ability to, you know, the shield block gives him a lot of armor, and primarily that's what he's looking for. Because if there's a quartermaster, he needs to be above at least 9 health at this point. All right, nicely done. He can play the Acolyte in the Cruel Task, or the Cruel Task armor up. I think he will value the health total quite a bit.
Yeah, the worst thing that can happen is that there is indeed the quartermaster. Then it's 6 damage, but then you still are not afraid of dying here.
Yeah, you're not even dead to quartermaster, True Server Champion. Mm-hmm. So you'd be dead to nothing pretty much at this point. Like on this exact turn, it probably wouldn't happen.
Well, double quartermaster would actually be it, but yeah, that's kind of
right. Oh my God, you're right. That's an extra 2 damage. All right, so Vortex does go for the card draw. He's going to replenish his options to keep pressuring the warrior. There's the owl in Stansifka's hand, but that Tyrion won't be executable for now.
Yeah, and it's a really good answer to all into the Tyrion, but it's still going to be a pretty powerful creature on the board with just being in 6-6.
Would you just go phase here if you're Vortex? There's no reason to trade, right? Because the warrior should do it himself. Might as well just go face and threaten the quartermaster.
Yeah, actually like it. Then you also, like, the warrior is low on life and super annoying. There is indeed the big EH.
Double big game hunter.
I said it. I wasn't sure if he played it anymore, but I know that he likes it. And I guess we're just going to see maybe tempo BGHs again, Noxious. Do you remember Starletter?
Yeah.
It was like, he had like the double BGH that he just fought people while still wearing Handlock, and actually everybody ran away with Handlock, and the only thing he was playing with the BGHs was just playing them on tempo, sometimes play them into the brawl, hoping to win brawls.
Yeah, with Quartermaster, you know, like with the Cruel Task Master, sorry, he just goes, you know, Cruel Task Master is a 5-5, and then BGHs it. The fact that you can enable that BGH through Cruel Task gives it additional value. And it kind of incentivizes you to be running double Cruel Task and double BGH. But it's a very specific choice. It's just that when you know that Dr. Boom is everywhere, it's an okay choice, I think.
Yep.
Oh, man. Where's Equality now? Aldor Peacekeeper wouldn't do anything, so I kind of like this play, because if Aldor Peacekeeper ended up being played on the 10 attack Grom that's already enraged, you would not be able to enrage it afterwards. However, if Aldor falls down here, it still gets enraged, you know, up to 6 more attacks, so it goes up to 7.
And how afraid are you actually of this Grommash at the moment? You don't have to be that afraid yet, I think. If it is not enraged, there is Tyrion on board, you're 26 life. I think it's actually fine to just ignore it here.
All right, so Tyrion is threatening, if anything, is threatening 6 damage, which is more than enough to scare you. But you can clean up the board quite well with the Grom, but how likely do you think you are to survive next turn?
I don't know what your options are. Like, there's no other really good way to deal with the Tyrion. You can execute it, but then you need leave the Knife Juggler up, and you just draw the boom, and maybe you just have to hope here for...
That's game.
Not much...
That is game. 10 damage with the True Server Champion. If Stansifka had decided to armor up instead of playing the Dr. Boom somehow, he might have been able to do it. But the thing is, I think he was counting on his opponent having lethal anyway on the following turn. And he said, if I don't go all in now, I'm still losing next turn. So I've got to make the play.
Yeah, and actually, Vortex, like always these 1-1s that he attacked aggressively into the face of Stansifka actually really paid off. He could play it a bit more passively, more from control, that he might have won too, but these extra damages really did a lot of work.
Yeah, one of the things to keep in mind as well is the fact that those, you know, the Acolyte and the Cruel Taskmaster, you know, they were on 1 health with Equality. You know, usually, naturally, you will trade into them, but that extra 2 damage is exactly what he needed to get to win. If it wasn't for that one attack, I think he wouldn't have had enough damage output.
Yeah, so Sifka or Vortex tying up here the series now, and going for a priest here, and it is the Dragon Priest from Stansifka.
With a perfect start, this is Zombie Chow for 1. Granted, you don't get the Wormist Agent, which is a bit unfortunate, but you do get a 2-3 on turn 1, which contests the enemy Zombie Chow. You can heal your own, and they can't heal theirs, so you've got to just be worried about, you know, Muster for Battle, Cog Hammer, to finish off your own 2-3.
Okay, so how do you think of this matchup? I know, like, people say Dragon Priest is, like, pretty good against Secret Paladin, yeah, but how is it against mid-range Paladin?
I feel like Lightbone still does a lot of work against mid-range. Like, you still, a lot of their minions are still very vulnerable to the light bomb kind of burst that you pull out. So I still think Priest is favored overall, no matter what.
Yeah, it's a really closer matchup because the Paladin deck has a lot of value and has better ways of dealing with minions sometimes. But, like, especially Cabal, if you can just make, like, a good steal and there are minions having a lot of health, like, the Priest has a lot for this matchup.
Yeah, so here, what Stensivka did, just healing the Whelp, make sure he plays on curve on 3, but he's still vulnerable to Muster for Battle or Cog Hammer, both of which, right now, Vortex has. Vortex is actually really weapon clock at the moment, right? He's got the Cog Hammer, the Muster for Battle, the True Summer Champion, and he's not going to play anything else until turn 3. So it's a little bit weird. Now, in this case, I think Stensivka's got a good incentive to go and play the Quiet Whelp. There's almost no reason not to.
Yeah, it's getting weaker how later you play it, and it kills the Zombie Chao here. Not really good, but it at least does something here, yeah. Still.
Well, that's a bit clunky. Double Muster for Battle. Sure, the 1-1s are great, but if there's any such thing as a single board clear, you know, on 5 before your Quartermaster, you're going to be in a world of trouble.
That's totally true. But yeah, I mean, this turn it should still be pretty decent. You can even use your weapon here first to make sure you still get all the full light justice.
Yeah, there's a value out of... I feel like Vortex is in a great spot right now, but it doesn't take much for Stensivka to just swing back in. That is not the card he wants on this turn.
And this is sometimes the problem with Priest in general. Like, you have a lot of spells still, you have some expensive minions, you have these minions that get a bit... That are just a bit really annoying to play at. And also with dragons, you sometimes are missing the dragons, what makes minions a bit weaker. Yeah, it's sometimes really hard. The Dragon Priest can sometimes just beat himself, I feel.
Yeah, like every minion you play is situational. And because it's all situational, even your dragon cards are situational because of the condition to enable them. And as a result of that, you very often find yourself with bad top decks. All right, so he's playing this before... I mean, maybe he doesn't think he'll ever get any value out of it if he just holds on to it. So he's just got to hope that either the Paladin trades with everything or plays True Server Champion instead of something like Shredder.
Yeah, it takes a turn a bit away from the Paladin. I mean, you still have to face another charge of the True Silver Champion, and it doesn't really make your Ezreal Drake that good.
Yeah, and you're still not able to clean this board up with Holy Nova. Not yet, at least.
Oh, if he really wanted that dragon last turn, that would be perfect.
Feels bad, man. But he does, by playing like this, if Quartermaster comes out, he's trading two of his 3-3s into it, or a charge of the True Silver and one of the minions. So he's got to be pretty happy. So either a lot of the 1-1s are gone, or the 3-6 just doesn't get killed, and there's very little tempo from Vortex.
I actually really like the new card for the Dragon Priest, or for the dragons in general, like the Twilight Guardian. That card made, yeah, like, people were always trying the dragons out, but this was finally in card. It was like the missing thing for dragon decks, that you had like a mid-range card and 3 or 4 drop that was just really powerful stat-wise.
Yeah, and this is pretty much what Blizzard, you know, I talked to them and they said, that's kind of what we do. We just let archetypes span out, and if it doesn't work, we'll just give them specific tools. But right now, Stensivka picked up 2 Novas back-to-back, which would not necessarily be exciting, but his Drake will live because he found the Power Root Shield. So he will be getting 3 damage AoE, which will pop the Shredder, kill the Belcher, and heal the Drake all at once.
Oh, wow, then it's not a total board clear, but it makes the board also pretty weak.
Yeah, it really weakens the board, which means you're able to get to that turn 8, where you can go for a Nova, a Shadow of Death on something like Dr. Boom. Then you'd curve into Ysera. The Paladin needs equality. Otherwise, you're just going to start getting way too much value. Here we go. What is it?
It is Milhouse.
Wow, so, I mean, you do have to heal your Drake, but if anything, this is the only minion Stensivka probably just didn't want to see at all.
Like, even an annoying Devrattle minion, Colt would just be stolen next turn with the Cabal, right. And he's even golden, look.
Yeah, it's pretty swaggy. Yeah. Wow. Wait, Valen's chosen Holy Nova. You could simply kill Dr. Boom on the back of that, but Shadow or Death.
Ooh, this is a pretty tough turn, actually, what the right call is here.
Would you... Nah, I was gonna say, would you Cabal Shadow Priestess, but there's mini bots left. Shadow or Death looks pretty clean to me. I like it a lot. I mean, this is a turn 8 we were talking about, where you go Death Nova. The problem is right now you're not killing Milhouse, but if you go Valen's Chosen Nova, you hit for 4 damage, spell damage, which means you kill Milhouse and the Boombots, and then you can trade your Drake if it took less than 3 damage from the Boombots into Dr. Boom, and keep it alive.
Yeah.
A little weird. Maybe you just Valen's Chosen Shadow or Death, but I don't think that's good.
It looks such a...
Well, that's good, right? It tanked everything.
It's like either just go all face or just ignore the Drake.
Right.
To have still the minion on board or let just the minion take all the damage. And yeah, I think you just can make it straight. You can even consider maybe face, but I don't know about that.
If you go face, you're banking on Shadow or Death taking care of the Dr. Boom next turn or forcing your opponent to trade.
Oh, wow. And that's actually...
That is insane.
After seeing double Holy Nova, this has to be a pretty strong turn.
Stan Sivka's gonna have to find a light bomb. Oh, he's being greedy about this because he's seen the Nova. He knows there's no Wild Pyromancer in this Priest deck.
Yeah, there is nothing that can really go bad. Like, otherwise it might just die already to light bomb. But now you get like the charge in from the plus two if Sivka holds on to the light bomb.
All right, so that's one Cabal. I mean, the second Cabal technically could steal the Quartermaster if you ever steal like a mini bot and then a Quartermaster. Like, Aether Awakens would be sick.
So this is actually...
This is 12, disgusting.
12, 14, 15, 17 damage. So not lethal yet, 3 off. And oh, there is actually the double Quartermaster, so he actually plays it.
So I think you start with Equality, and then you trade Zombie Chow.
Yeah.
And then you just go Hero just, Power, Quartermaster.
Or just attack face, maybe. You can. Is it really bad to take the 4 damage?
Oh, yeah, that's right, with Light's Justice. Mm-hmm. I guess so. Yeah, I mean, it's hardly going to backfire ever, but now that's...
The Swords are getting in here, and wow, this is a lot of damage for Vortex. Wow. So many Swords.
2 arms, man. Light Bomb is necessary. That's not it. So I don't think there's a way Stan Sivka gets this. He's going to concede and lose the Priest to the Paladin. And he's going to have to beat that Paladin somehow. Whether he uses his Tempo Mage or his Handlock. Probably Handlock.
Yeah, I think Handlock has a decent shot. But mid-range Paladin is hard for Handlock. Like, they have so many answers with the Equality, the Eldors. I don't know if they're BGH, but in general, Paladin has some really class cards that are already good against an Handlock. Well, Tempo Mage, it can do really well if you have the Flame Wakers and the Arcane Missiles. Like, it deals with these early 1-1s from the Muster or what, something like that. But decides to go with the Handlock here, and I think it's the right call.
Well, it's probably some kind of demon variant of it. It seems like Handlock nowadays is synonymous with demons. You barely see the typical Handlock anymore. It's usually going to be the Voidcaller approach with Mal'Ganis.
Yeah. And I think it, I don't know if it really makes this matchup much better, but in general, it it is just a bit better against the aggro classes. Against mid-range classes, it's pretty close.
Well, the Hellfire is amazing. The Voidcaller is great, because you can get another Voidcaller or the Doomguard. So this start, although it's a bit slow, it's still a really solid one. But oh my god, the pressure. See, he does play Justicar Trueheart in that Paladin list.
Oh, wow.
I asked him 2 days ago and he said, well, I can't say anything for sure. I can neither confirm nor deny, but...
If people say, I cannot say anything about that, then you can almost already guarantee, right? Otherwise, you say, no, I don't play it, maybe.
Yeah, politics.
It's
the same way, right?
Yeah.
What do you plan to do about healthcare? I can neither confirm nor deny that I'm not doing anything, but... I'm not doing anything.
So, first Void Caller getting here on the board. I think the only thing you don't want to get from it is the second one. Because you have 4 demons in hand. You really hope to get here the Doom Guard or the Jiraxxus to play your another Void Caller next turn, I think.
Yeah, Jiraxxus is a problem only because of Equality. But if there's no Equality, then you're going to be able to just stop every single bit of damage until you reach your late game.
So, Vortex, is he gonna attack into the Voidcaller? I mean, you have to deal with it anyways. Turn 3 is a really early Voidcaller. He decides to not trade into it, actually. with the BKH in hand, I mean, maybe he's just setting it up for the Mal'Ganis. If there comes out Mal'Ganis, he just trades into the Void Caller and can BKH the Mal'Ganis. But unfortunately, the only demon not in the hand from Sansipka is Mal'Ganis.
Yeah, he's going to have to find a better way to deal with this. Maybe Lotheb is the better play, simply because that plus the mini-bot will trade into the Doomguard at some future point, but it still hurts.
Yeah, when Knife Jiggler Mister looks like a pretty decent turn, you don't want to give away your true Silver Charge, I think.
Yeah, but now the Hellfire from Stansifka is going to be even better.
Reporting for duty. Is he going to hit the knife here? Nope. Knife Jiggler goes face.
Yeah, do you Hellfire here if you're Stansifka? Is that ever necessary? Or, because I mean, you could get your Draxus right now and set up the taunt as soon as possible, but you are going
into turn... Oh, and there's actually the Mal'Ganis now. It's actually pretty bad to get here now.
Okay, this is a weird turn for Stansifka, because if he's playing around Equality Consecration, Draxus is pretty bad.
Yeah.
And it's turn 6, right? So this is kind of the Equality Consecration turn.
But Equality is already painful, but still having these minions on board, Equality does already a lot here.
Yeah. I mean, I think at this point, Vortex would have to get it in order to clean this up. And... Oh!
Is there Rexus coming out of the...
Vortex is wondering, what did I do to this world? I don't have anything to answer this.
I thought I played against Handlock. I kept my BKH in the starting hand. What are all these demons doing?
Yeah. I remember this morning, somebody was playing a Zoot on ladder. And they asked Zalay, what do you think this guy's playing? Zalay said, oh, he's going to be playing Demon Lock. And then out come the Flame Imps and Voidwalkers. And the guy's like, you told me he was playing Demon Lock. He says, yeah, look, there's demons.
Yeah.
It's actually just... it's just the big ones. I don't know. I just feel like sometimes... As Paladin, you wish you had double equality, but playing two of them just makes you feel miserable.
It is so weak in some certain matchup, and it's indeed super situational. And yeah, I mean, if you have it in the mirror against like an aggro secret Paladin, it's not that good.
Oh, Twitch chat, I love you. You're the reason I even do Hearthstone stuff. Yeah. All right, that being said, I think right now Stansifka's in a position that's I don't want to say unlosable because that'd be false, but he's pretty close to that spot. Not seeing equality last turn gives him probably the information, almost the perfect information, that there is none. Otherwise, he would have seen it for sure. So he's safe to develop pretty much everything he wants. He even has the owl to clear up the void, the powdered shredder, and the Doomguard can punch face. He's setting up lethal for next turn.
Yeah, and I think the last turn said already a lot for to Stansifka. You didn't saw anything happening then. There cannot be any equality, and well, there is a consecration draw. Equality was kind of needed there. They love you too, Noxious. Do you see
that? They say that now.
Yeah.
All right. So, Buster for Battle doesn't do anything here really for Vortex. He is alive though. In his mind, he thinks he's gonna make it through. There's only 7 damage on board. He's gonna be able to do 3 more with Hellfire, but he doesn't have the full lethal yet.
I think this is to just keep your both minions alive. The Hellfire looks pretty good here. You can see if there's something you can draw. You can use it as cycle.
What could be in that deck? All right, might as well just taunt up. It's very, very safe.
And then you can guarantee win next turn. Yeah, you just have to guarantee win next turn.
This was actually a really interesting game because we didn't see Giants at all.
Yeah, that's the funny thing. Like, Vortex kept one card. It's the BGH, and you will say, yeah, that's an... Oh, I'm so happy. Oh, and there's the equality. Just turn too late. Well, actually, together with the low tap,
that's enough to lock down the lethal. All right.
Oh, wow. Well, it's not over yet, guys. We lied.
Maybe Lay on Hands gets picked up after this.
Yeah, or in Healbot. I don't know if there's room for that in the deck, but a lot of versions still playing with at least one Healbot.
I really think... So what could Stansifka find? He could find a Dark Bomb, right? And hit the opponent's face for not exactly lethal, but one overkill, just based on that.
Is there any way that Vortex can pick up something that can give him lethal? I don't really think so, right?
So 5-6.
Ooh, there is a Molten Giant.
Well, that's a taunt if I've ever seen one. But BGH is going to do a lot of work. And you're going to be able to use Foghammer.
He might lose now if there is not going to be any help, but at least he played his BGH.
Yeah, at least he got to kill.
This is like
This is bittersweet.
Yeah,
this is so bittersweet. One more mana would have allowed him to. Oh no, two. He would have needed more than that actually to play Lay on Hands because he had to kill the 8/8 giant. But actually, the taunting up the Lotheb, he thinks might let him live.
Wow, and actually the early pressure from the demons are carrying Sivka here to the second victory.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like this wasn't even a textbook handlog game. Usually you see handlog just go turn 4 Drake or turn 4 Giant. But in this case, it was really just, oh, I'm going to play Voidcaller and then another Voidcaller, get my two best demons and not be vulnerable to whatever removal you've got in hand. Mm-hmm. So it was kind of, it's not something you see very often.
No, but it is the thing why people actually play the demon handlock version now. You have more options. It's, you can, the most valuable option now is a lot of times you can already play something at turn 3. You either coin out your Drake, you can follow it up with a Voidcaller, or you do it different wise, you have more demons. It's actually, and they are really healthy too. So if you can taunt them up with the Argus or Sunfree, it's pretty good against aggro.
Right, you're always getting, because they still have more health than they have attack, so you're able to get a really big wall against mid-range decks. And the thing is, the way the Doomguard operates is that it's that kind of that wild card in the deck that nobody really, you can't really play around it at all. You have to play around the Draxxus, you have to play around the Mal'Ganis, but the Doomguard is not something that you have to plan for. And when it comes out on curve after the Voidcaller, that's just a complete blowout as well.
And you saw Vortex actually having the answer for Mal'Ganis, and it's actually weird that Mal'Ganis, it's like the most heavy cost minion, but it's like almost always the weakest to get out of the...
Right. You're happy sometimes, but very often it's going to lose you the game because a tempo BGH, I mean the BGH on curve, will simply deny you any tempo you would have gained from the Voidcaller Battlecry.
Yeah, and even, if you compare it with the Doomguard, I mean they have both the same life total, and yeah, the Doomguard has the charge. So it's already... a lot of times that even or super close.
Yeah, you can use it proactively instead of waiting. So the player, I mean, it's the best of seven, so it's not over yet. It might look like it's over because we have Caster Cam, but we just have to kill time because Stensivka's gone. Yeah. Might have to get some bananas or something, I'm not sure.
Yeah. Like, or maybe, I think he had like, just went to the supermarket and I see a lot of bananas already ready.
There's a banana
there. Yeah, I guess just a break.
Yeah, no, I don't think...
Probably need to break, maybe to the toilet and...
Oh, sure. That sounds human.
Mm-hmm. Actually, we see a chocolate bar there too.
Yeah, so. I'm going to read his deck list from these notes.
Look at these. Like, you can see, I think the left side is all the name of the cards, and then he like writes down if it's drawn or not. And in some matchups, it's it doesn't really matter, but in some matchups where it goes to fatigue or to the last cards of the deck, it's sometimes super important.
Oh, he's come back for his banana. There we go. Wow. The apple juice refill.
Yeah. Reload.
All right, he's ready to go. Mm-hmm. He nods in approval.
Yeah.
So one of the things about Stensivka that I love is just how zen he is about the game. Mm-hmm. Sure, he does get stressed out when he's on stage or there's high pressure, but he takes losses very well, I find. I think maybe the amount of Magic the Gathering he's played, which is a very high variance game, lets him do that. So it's a very chill guy. Yeah.
I think it's a really good attitude that he has, and maybe an attitude that is really helping him here into the game in general.
Yeah.
It's a good approach.
All right, so we're going to have a handlock mirror
match
based on this.
So what do you think is really important in this mirror? Like, some people say, yeah, you need to have the threats, and other people say you need to have the answers. What is the best thing?
I think it depends on your starting hand, what you're going to choose for. Because it really, like, depending on what your first 3 to 4 cards are, you're going to make up your mind as to what you're looking for based on that. Because sometimes if you find a Drake, you might want to pose the question. If you find an owl, you might take the other approach, right?
Yeah. So no, I can see that.
It's a bit difficult, though, to make up your mind. Because you're still going to be tapping for about 3 turns straight.
What do we see for a tech card for Vortex? I cannot believe this.
No.
I cannot believe this.
No. Vortex.
What is going on?
Vortex, you did not.
Oh, wow. This is going to be a really awkward Draxxus.
I mean, this is a BGH.
I cannot believe this.
This is the answer he's got for the Draxxus that is not Mal'Ganis and that you can't BGH. Oh. And there's the Draxxus for Stensivka already. Oh. It might be something he considers to play for the late game. But if he does,
This is so long time ago that I saw this card here. being played or just in general. Oh my god, I cannot believe it.
But here's the deal though. One thing to say about the Sacrificial Pact as well is that it is good against Tempo Mage in a weird way, because you feed them a demon through Mirror Entity and then you can kill it. It lets you play, it's a very marginal situation, but you can find those weird spots. It's good against Sylvanas. When she steals her demon that you have, that's also really big, you can sometimes just get the value back. It's also, that's not why you put it in your deck.
You can also kill your own Fort Caller, like when you made a trade, right. It's like a 3-1 or a 3-2, you want to get your demon on the board and you can use it on your own demon.
Exactly, so there are a lot more uses to it than it looks. It looks like a Dreadsteed gimmick, and it really, that's what it is, but sometimes it has uses beyond the obvious, let's kill Jiraxxus.
Yeah, and... Well, but there still has to be, like, the Jiraxxus has to be played himself. I mean, a lot of times with the Fort Caller deck, Jiraxxus just gets on board. If a Fort Caller gets drawn, it's really likely Jiraxxus gets on board, and then it's still super good.
Yeah, but, 15 damage for 0
it's not
mana.
Lethal.
Yeah. It's still solid enough. So the giant, the first giant comes down from Stan Sivka, and there's no BGH in Vortex's hand to answer it. So it's going to be a little difficult to handle it. I mean, your Belcher dies, and then you have to trade away your Drake with the Slime. You're probably going to have to do some shenanigans with Dark Bomb to get it done.
It's actually, yeah, both players don't have any answers to Drakes, to Giants. It's just they have to just play their own threats and see what's getting out of that.
All right, so if you're a Stan Sivka here, do you try to play Emperor Thorsen on this board? It's very hard not to, because you are threatening... are very dangerous.
For him, it's not that hard to. Seems that he just thinks, I want to play the Drake here.
Yeah, it's like, if there's a Shadow Flame, I don't really care. Mm.
Oh. Yeah, and Drake, super healthy here.
Yeah. All right, well, Vortex is going to go for Sylvanas here, put a lot of pressure on his opponent, because the board that Stan Sivka is offering him is amazing, Sylvanas.
Actually, making here the value trade, it's a bit risky, but it feels like that you can get a really high reward of it, because there, if he doesn't trade into Sylvanas, or if he trades, there's just you make sure you don't get the Watcher anymore.
Yeah, now here, if you attack into, say you attack into the Drake with your Giant, so if it gets stolen, you can coil it, and if it doesn't get stolen, then you're still in a good spot.
Then he has a Yeti.
Yeah, exactly.
And there is the Yeti.
All right, and there was no Mortal Coil earlier from Vortex. There was a point where he could use it on your Owl, and he didn't.
Yeah, that's
which
true.
Which means there is no Coil for this Giant, probably, which means you're probably going to be getting yourself a trade or an overkill through Dark Bomb, something along those lines.
Yeah, so Sivka has here option to play the Emperor this turn. It is, with the 8-1 Giant being left, like, you probably want to play something. It looks really weak. It just dies to Mortal Call, or in a bit better situation, it dies to Dark Bomb. But yeah, you probably want to play at least something else. And actually, the Twilight Drake with the Taunt.
Now, on the Giant, that forces your opponent to have the Coil, or something like a Dark Bomb, of course, like we just spoke of. So... yeah, still no Coil for Vortex, so he's going to make the trade. And Sylvanas was a lot less fruitful than he might have liked. But that's really just... I mean, could you play for value and Dark Bomb the Giant and attack the Sun Fury?
Yeah.
Or do you want to play Dr. Boom at all costs?
What I actually think that Sivka's maybe doing, maybe he's waiting for the Emperor to get it on the Jiraxxus, and it will be 8 mana, and then you might just, on turn 10, you can go Jiraxxus with an Hero Power already. And
yeah.
Then, and just having a 6-6 for 2 mana, I think it's pretty good.
It's pretty good until Sacrificial Pact.
Yeah. But he doesn't know yet.
This is going to be an amazing... It's kind of the Hungry Crab. The Hungry Crab of the...
Oh, wow. These bombs, so aggressive.
I'm not sure what you'd do if you're Stan Sivka in this position. I mean, Dr. Boom is not manageable, but you can definitely go for something like Belcher. The problem with playing Jiraxxus, as you said, is that you want to kind of get your Giants out before you do that. So you might just go for Belcher tap.
Yeah, like tapping feels really valuable with double Molten Sin in the hand. And normally, actually, the handlock that can play the Molten Giants first is ahead.
By a long shot, yeah.
Yeah, because you just have like these two extra minions that you can play in the mirror match, and where your opponent is just not allowed to play them yet.
So if you play Defend of Argus here, you are forcing Dr. Boom to attack and then Shadow Flame. At least something along those lines, or a Hellfire plus an attack, which kills the Dr. Boom itself. So Defend of Argus looks solid, but Belcher as well. So.
Yeah, and Molten is feels pretty risky here. There are some ways that you might die with a double dark bomb and a 4 mana card that deals some damage, like an Hellfire.
Yeah, so Stensivko ran out of time there. I think he picked up the Belcher. I'm not sure if that was his final choice, if he's satisfied with it. But it definitely, it's good enough.
Mordekaiser getting picked a bit too late. Will be really good into the giant before, but
yeah, it's still fine. You can find a spot for it at some point for sure.
Oh, and there is the fourth call. Actually, I think the Vortex is pretty happy with that, with the double demons in hand.
Yeah, the Mal'Ganis and the Jiraxxus. Whichever one you get, you're probably happy with.
Yeah, I think. Like, in some way, you want the Jiraxxus on board because it's way harder to kill. And, like, Mal'Ganis dies pretty easily if you are behind on board. But then another side, Jiraxxus, you also want to play it. Because it's like a high value card in this matchup that most often goes to a value matchup.
I mean, if you find Emperor Thoris, then of course Jiraxxus becomes better, as you said, because you can get your hero power immediately. It's kind of like having the Jiraxxus coin hero power, except now it's actually viable. Alright, so he's going to go for the board caller. He's setting himself up to get a really big demon out of this, and he's going to let the board sit there because he's not afraid of losing anything for the time being.
Okay. Well, unfortunately, I don't think this is a Jiraxxus turn, but still the Molten's in the hand. You really want to play them first.
Yeah, you want to make sure that those Molten's are out of your hand long before you play Jiraxxus, because at that point you have to get down to one health to pay six, I think. How much is it? Yeah, it's six mana to play them at that point. That's not really realistic. Giant is good. This Giant here lets you life tap, which lowers your health even further for the Molten's that you can play next turn and probably just get a crazy swing.
Like, a tap Giant is good, but the Emperor also a lot of value here.
You're right.
Emperor himself.
It's kind of like a life tap for your Molten's, but it affects everything else.
Yeah, and you just have like 8 mana less in your hand, kind of.
Yeah, it's a lot of innervates. Double Coil, wow, just to taunt him.
Yeah.
That looks like a Shadow Flame to me, but I may be wrong.
Might be time indeed to deal at least something with the board.
I think he wants to wait until the Molten's come out just to get a big 8-8. Like, if the Molten's come out and you're not able to use Shadow Flame on your own Molten, then you're going to be in a pretty tricky situation.
But yeah, for sure Emperor has to die here. If you leave an Emperor up for a long time against Handlock, they have so many heavy cost cards, and if they get cheap, it gets super dangerous.
Yeah, I actually like the play that Vortex made is by far better than Shadow Flaming. I mean, you're barely even getting a clear here. You'd have to wait. You really have to wait until you get like a 2 for 3, 2 for 4 sometimes. Make sure that your single Molten kills two of theirs, ideally. Oh, wow. That's kind of unfortunate.
It looks good for the Into the Twilight Drake still. Kind of.
It's clunky because you've just played your coils and life tapped at the end of the turn here. Didn't let him find that option first. He cycled with the coils at the end, or one of them.
Yeah.
All right.
So how scary is Sivka of this Void Caller here? I mean, he doesn't have good answer at all into if there comes out in Jiraxxus or in Mal'Ganis. So Void Caller is pretty annoying here.
I mean, double Molten Sun Fury or, you know, Life Tap, double Molten, that means you're paying 6 mana to get everything on the board. And that's a very cheap board flood. You can play 3 Giants if you want. I don't think you might want to overextend that much. But if you leave your opponent on 17, right, there's no way he can go Molten, Shadow Flame.
Yeah, just if you stay to the 17 life total, that's actually perfect.
Wow, now the Giants look really good. Now they look insane.
It was kind of a ballsy move. Like, if Mal'Ganis would come out, it might
get... Shadow Flame.
Yeah, but do you really want to give your turn away by Molten Giant Shadow Flame because of one Mal'Ganis?
Right. I don't know. Right now, Stensivka is in a great spot. And Vortex hasn't taken enough damage to go for Molten Shadow Flame. I think that's exactly what Stensivka's counting on right now. I think Vortex is going to be forced to try to taunt up the Jiraxxus to make sure it tanks as much damage as possible. Treat it as an extra 15 health. And from there, you can probably figure out how to get your opponent to use Jiraxxus and Sack Pact.
Yeah, even like just playing Mal'Ganis on himself, like it buffs the Jiraxxus, but it doesn't do anything here.
Right.
It makes no trades possible. And it's another really good hand where he can do anything.
Oh,
that is actually a really sick draw here.
An amazing... That's probably the only draw in his deck that he was looking for off the top.
Yeah, maybe something together with a Shadow Flame called Hell, but this is for sure the best one. Big Game Hunter.
And you Belcher, I guess. It protects Adraxis a little bit for all that's worth, and then next turn you can have a guaranteed Shadow Flame with Molten if you need it.
Yeah, it is. Molten feels super risky here with already 11 damage on board being on 15 lives. Maybe you can use the sexual, or you can use the pact on your own Adraxis, but I don't really like that.
Yeah, you'd be dead to what? Second Owl, you'd be taking 11 damage off the board, so he needs to find 4 more on top of the Owl. That would be really close.
Well, and is Shadow there... Flame, if you Shadow Flame your Molten, you...
Wait, Shadow Flame Molten, then Dark, then attack with the 2-3.
11. Yeah, it's lethal,
I think. It's lethal with Hellfire, no, Dark Bomb. Yeah, I think it is. You Molten, Shadow Flame, attack the Slime, then attack phase, Dark Bomb, Hellfire. That is it.
But that is that's 11 mana.
He's missing 1 mana.
Yeah. And,
so that would be the kill. What if you don't use the...
What if you Hellfire here
exactly,
first?
What if you Hellfire first, and then you do the exact...
Then you're just gonna...
You Molten for 0, then you have the extra Mana Crystal, you can Shadow Flame, go face and win with the Dark Bomb. We'll never see the sack back, and that sucks.
That sucks.
But, nicely played by Stance here.
I will see in the leaf of... It was... There was so much in the hand, so much possibilities there. It had to be like a way to get the leaf in there. And
he had to lose the health.
We are not going to see the pack being played, guys. Not yet.
Sad days.
Aww.
I'm disappointed, but that's a really good lethal from Stancivka. Very well played game for both players.
So, actually, Vortex going into a super hard matchup now with the Priest into the handlock. It's not the matchup you want with the Priest, I think.
Maybe it's the matchup you deserve. I don't know. It's one of those things where if you have Light Bombs, it really helps a lot. But if you don't have the Light Bombs, you're going to be pretty much like from behind, playing from behind all game. And that's going to be really awkward for Vortex. Yeah,
it's still fine. Sometimes with the Velen nowadays, you can really get some good trades off into Twilight Drakes at least, and you have Shadow Redes for the Giants. Sometimes it goes pretty close, but no silence, and I don't think it can really handle Adraxis in the early game.
It's I mean, he's got a Chill Maw, but that won't help until very later. So that's a very slow start already for the Priest. Doesn't mean he can't actually get away with the game, but if you can tempo very quickly in the early game with... there's a Chromagus. Oh, wow. So he is getting the 2-3 on his first turn. I don't think that's going to bother Stancivka too much with the hand he's got. He can just coin Voidcaller next turn or tap and tap.
Vortex already struggling a bit, but I mean, Chill Maw and Chromagus, it's not like the hand you are looking for at the start. And
it isn't, yeah.
How cool these 2-3 Twilight Bulbs look. It doesn't really matter for hand luck almost.
Yeah, if they have a Hellfire, they'll clean them up. If they have a Voidcaller, they'll 2-for-1. And Vortex right now is not happy to see this demon.
No, and that is the kind of the weak point here for the Priest deck. It has no way of dealing with the mid-range creatures that are having these mid-range stats, and especially Voidcaller that can just summon another demon.
Yeah. So right now Vortex says, you know, if you have Hellfire, then so be it. You know, Hellfire and get Adraxis, then just take it. There's very little I can do about it. Luckily for him, though, that's not the case.
So, there's still a nice valuable trade here on the board into one of the Twilight Bulbs. You can even consider silencing the 2-5, but we'll make it in 2-1.
To make sure that you can trade with it immediately, but...
Yeah, but I don't know if... what are the silence targets you want? You probably want one for your Yashira if something totally goes wrong that you might need it. There is always the option with the Velen. I don't know if there is an Sylvanas. I can actually not see a Sylvanas in the deck with a Chill Maw and Chromagus and... I mean, there has to be in Yashira too, right? So I cannot see in Sylvanas in that deck. But
Vortex did play a really weird control warrior. Yesterday, we saw him play a very, very greedy control warrior list with, you know, Nexus Champion, Sarad, Nefarian, Ysera. Maybe he took the same approach to build his Priest. But we'll have to see whether or not that's in there. For now, he's got a turn 5 with the Blackwing Corruptor. He's also got the opportunity of using Holy Nova. But unfortunately, there really isn't that much on this board that you're happy to Nova too much. And Stancivka's just going to take the easy trade, prevent the heal from Vortex.
So now it's up to Vortex. How do you want to react? You have the Blackwing Corruptor here on curve. It's pretty good. But you're so scared of this card. And I mean, what is coming out of it?
Anything that comes out of this
is bad.
Exactly. The only thing you might be happy about is something like Mal'Ganis, because your 5-3 and your 2-3 would be able to trade into it. That's just like the only thing you might be fine with. And if it's a Doomguard like this, you can just hit it and then trade. But
yeah, I will be happy with just nothing seeing getting out of it.
Right.
That will be the best case, but
yeah.
Really rarely, right?
You don't always get what you want.
Sometimes you can just bluff it, but yeah. I mean, if you coin it out at turn 3 and having no 4-drop.
Right, I mean, Elky did a really good play like that. Recently we saw him play Zoo, I think, against Oskaka. He actually bluffed not having a demon because he considered going face, where if you had a demon, usually he would have made the trade. So you definitely can bluff in some circumstances, but this is not really one where you'll be able to pull it off. And the priest is so afraid that the bluff is still not going to work.
Yeah, so Sipka, having 5 mana here, can try to. There is no really good way of removing it at all. But if you want to play the Belcher, you kind of have to trade it. Otherwise, the trade into the Belcher with the Black and Corruptor is too good.
And you let the priest heal, which is something you don't want to do. Don't let him get that extra bit of healing value. Oh, wow.
Oh, wow.
Jiraxxus was no issue, after all.
We had the same reaction. Like, oh, a Shadow of Death, and actually it even does pretty decent work against an Handlock.
Yeah, and right now, Stan Sivka is sitting in a weird hand that doesn't have much besides, you know, situational cards. He doesn't have the Power Giants. He doesn't have the... Never mind. There's a Drake. That changes a lot of things.
Yeah, and Drake might be even better than Giants in this case, so... Can probably tap with it, but do you want to give Priest cards? I mean, you know that there is going to be a trade now with the Cleric, with the heal back. It can just draw and... Giving Priest more options, more cards, it's a really scary thing.
Yeah, right now Vortex is going to be able to get himself the Chill Maw if he wants it. And he's got the... Well, he's got Cro-Magus and Vol'jin. So he's able to deal with a lot of the big threats just with the board that he's got right now.
Do you silence this? I mean...
It's kind of clunky, but I mean, it will kill your Drake otherwise. Even if you go for Argus and you trade the Drake and the Slime, everything still dies. So you might hope... I think silencing it is reasonable. And then you might go for an Argus between your two guys and kill the Chill Maw.
Yes.
It's a bit weird, though.
Stan Sivka has here a really low value hand where he has like all these situational cards that are not really doing much. So I actually like that he's really evaluating this Drake and wants to get as much value as he can out of the Drake.
Yeah. Holy Nova doesn't quite kill everything here. There is no way for... There's no spell damage on any minion.
Well, you can spell damage one of his minions. I mean, you killed two, but yeah, not really the play you want to make here.
Yeah, Vol'jin, Valens Chosen doesn't make sense considering you know there's Giants, you know there's Jiraxxus left, you know there's the Giant, like the...
But this is like a Cro-Magus turn, it's not really what you want to play around turn 8.
I would consider passing simply here because the value you're getting here is way too small. And there's a chance Stan Sivka is afraid of Light Bomb and simply doesn't play anything else. If he has Giants, he might consider not extending more. The Drake you're fine with because Light Bomb doesn't kill it. So, we'll see.
So, there is the second Drake. And, yeah, having that Shadow of Death from the start...
Oh, wow. Really good card here for Vortex.
Vortex also picking has also a really good combo in the hand. The Vol'jin together with the Holy Nova. It makes sure like the target that you take
you hit,
with the Vol'jin, it's just going to die from the Holy Nova.
Emperor Thorsten, that's a pretty high threat. Now, the thing is, do you use your Drake to trade or do you use your two small minions? Because you can't afford having this Drake on 2 health with Holy Nova around. Alright, well, he does make the right trade. But still, Vortex is going to get himself a decent Vol'jin. Not an amazing one, but a decent Vol'jin by trading into the Emperor. Do you just Shadow or Death, maybe? Is that better? Maybe Shadow or Death and then play Vol'jin on the Drake?
I mean, you can Vol'jin, but you don't really kill it off without using Holy Nova. So that's like you have to really spend the 10 mana turn for killing
Emperor,
it off. And what does it get? Yeah, it goes to 5 or 7 lives. It's not that much.
Yeah, I think maybe just Shadow or Deathing the Emperor is overall a lot better.
You cannot leave that Emperor up, so yeah, it is just needed.
Well, Stan Sivka, the cool thing about Stan Sivka's hand, it was low value, but these small, you know, these small cards that don't cost much are the type of cards that you're happy to get a reduction on because they're easier to weave in. Whereas the Giants already get their own discounts very often. I mean, sure, reducing their cost is the same as reducing these guys, but it's nice to get so many utility cards in the same hand when Emperor was triggered.
Yeah, and here now also having that one Molten Giant after seeing the Shadow of Death is pretty nice for Stansifka. Like, Stansifka didn't have much threats, but he seems to just pick up like one by one, picking it up, and it's just right. It seems to be like enough to pressure Vortex all the time.
Yeah, I mean, you can go, I mean, if you go for Molten Giant here, if you're Stan, again, Light Bombs on your mind, you're worried about that. The Shadow of Death has already been played, so you're not afraid of that, but the Light Bomb is an issue. If Light Bomb is used on a very small board like this one, you're probably okay with it. You have, you know, three more Giants left. You have a Mal'Ganis, so your threats are still in the deck.
Yeah, so...
Oh man, Senpo Big Game Hunter.
Oh, not playing the Giant. Like, this looks really like, oh, I'm just going to play everything. For, like, that is well how I will see it as a Vortex. So, it might be a board that you are, yeah, where you say, yeah, I'm probably just have to use my AoE here. So, maybe Sivka tries to just read Vortex here, like, do you have it or not? And then I can play it next turn.
This looks like a decent turn. I mean, the 3-6 with Taunt is good enough in this case. I think it does a lot of work. You've seen one Owl. Do you expect a second one? If you do, then of course, there's a weakness to using the Valence Chosen preemptively. You could play Drake, Northshire, heal yourself. The Guardian, that is.
Yeah. A Cleric together with the Velen, with the Nova, it kills off everything except the Fourth Caller. But do you even want to kill it off?
I don't think you do, yeah. It lets you also keep the minion. It will bait the Silence that Vol'jin won't eat, nor will Cro-Magnus.
Yeah, that's true. But you give away a good combo with Vol'jin.
It's good.
With Holy Nova. Yeah, this board is... It's a board that is... you don't really want to... put your AoE in, but it feels kind of needed, maybe.
Yeah, I think just getting that Void Caller down to one health is good enough because it doesn't give initiative to the opponent. All right, well, Vortex is going to play even more passively than we thought.
Oh, wow.
He's going to just try to get as much value, and he's going to try to get as much damage spread around on the enemy minions before he feels like he's forced to respond to this. And if Draxus comes on the board as a result of this Void Caller, Vol'jin is going to have a field day.
Yeah, and I think that's what Vortex mind thinking is here. Like, he knows there, like, he thinks there's just going to get a giant or a demon out of it, so he needs to save the answer. So many
possibilities. Double heal bot for Stansifka. All right, so that's an interesting turn for Stan because you want to kill that that dragon, and again, you could use your low health minions to do so. Because you're guaranteed to be able to keep them out of Holy Nova range, so you get value out of them where you otherwise thought you would not. So it's probably, even though it feels like a bad trade, you've still gotten a lot of mileage out of these guys.
Oh wow, he's trading everything in. He just doesn't want to have more than three or four creatures on the board at all.
With Light Bomb around, it's always very scary.
Yeah, it is, and just leaving the Void Caller up is, it might just be the right call. Like, it makes the turns really hard. Oh wow, that's actually a really good puck.
Unbelievable.
Yeah.
This is a tug of war.
But you cannot really do much together with it, right?
That's you'd have to go. I think right now might be a really good time to go for the Vol'jin. But you're not killing anything but the giant. That's the issue. There is 5 damage on board that's tradable. I mean, whoa.
Another Ironbeak. Demon.
You can go Ironbeak Owl, Juraxis yourself, trade the Void Caller. Then you have Mal'Ganis up. And then no matter what the priest does, killing all the 6/6s that start falling down is basically impossible.
There is one card priest totally cannot handle, and that is Lord Juraxis around turn 9 and turn 10. It's too early, the value is way too high, and there is no pact.
Very versus high.
There is no pact into a priest deck, unfortunately.
Yeah. Nefarian in the priest deck is Dragon.
Oh, yeah.
It could happen.
Well,
it could happen. Never say never.
Anything can happen, but wow.
Do you even want to get Mal'Ganis out here? Because the weakness of making that play is that Light Bomb will in fact give him perfect value.
It doesn't protect you, right? You are like immune, but does it protect you from...
From Sackback? Yeah, it does protect you from Sackback.
Oh, really?
It absolutely does.
Oh, wow.
So Nefarian has to be picked up now, and then Shadow of Death next turn needs to be played. So it's going to be a few turns away from being actually viable of a play. But Sylvanas will stop some of the problems that Vortex was running into here. It's a decent temple play. Drax is going to have to address it by feeding bad minions into it, but it's going to slow him down a bit. I have no time for games. Very
from now on, there will always be this Jirax's hero power. This, like, for two mana, just creating a 6/6, so super strong if you look at it value-wise.
Yeah.
The problem is, normally you just don't get to that point where you can make so much value out of it. But against the priest, it's super strong.
All right, so it looks like Stansifka is simply going to opt for, trading to the Sylvanas, giving maybe an owl if he's lucky. If he gives the owl, he can coil. And if he gives the watcher, he can kill it next turn. Perfect. That is the perfect outcome for Stansifka.
Okay, so I guess we need a Nivurian here from Vortex to keep his tournament alive.
I mean, it could absolutely happen, and that's the scary thing. He's probably hoping very strongly right now. All right, he gets a Nova clear on the two minions, and he even gets to keep his Cleric out of range of just the 6/6, and it will trade into it.
That's actually not bad at all. Of course,
we know there's a defender.
Well, it's still gonna be really hard to... like, every turn there is just a 6/6. Like, how are you gonna handle that
it's
in the long run?
It's easy. You stall for Nefarian.
Is there a Nefarian? Like, I don't know. How Chromagus, Nefarian, Ysera, Sylvanas, Chilmao. Like, it's a lot to play Nefarian in that deck.
That is Vortex.
Yeah, go full...
full greed.
If you go dragons, you go full dragons.
Never go full dragons. It's the new Northshire.
Yeah.
You can't go full dragons. So now what he did here by killing the... Like, he opted... He thought about going face with the Infernal, but he's like, what if he gets a card draw? That's not something I want to run into. Ysera is not going to give him any way to win. He's still dead on board.
And wow, and Sifka taking it here 4-2.
Yeah, I mean, Vortex is a little bumped out. You can see it on his face. His tournament life is off.
Yeah, unfortunately, it was a really good series, I think. We saw some really different decks, and both players going into another strategy where the one banned Warrior, the other one banned the Paladin.
Yeah, I really liked the way they both approached the mashup differently.
And, well, the Druid went out early for Vortex, and it might have really hurted him later.
Yeah.
Hi, so, guys.
Hi, it's Stansifka. Congratulations again for making it through to the next round. You're not done yet. So, first of all, Your Warrior deck, I have to talk about it because I feel like it's kind of a repeat of Star Ladder.
Yeah,
it's not the exact same thing, maybe, but it's
very
similar.
Much the same, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I already said it, like, we didn't start removal, but I was like, yeah, maybe he's still playing these double BGHs.
Yeah.
It's a really high value card, so I can totally understand.
It's good in some matchups, like, obviously, it's kind of shaky in some matchups. Like, for example, against the greedy Druid with Ragnaros and Dr. Boom, I feel very comfortable in this matchup because I had all the answers I needed, so.
Yeah, and you can also enable, you know, the Cruel Taskmaster, BGH shenanigans.
Yeah.
It's got a lot of versatility. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a lot of skill involved in this card. Like, it's not simple 7 mana minion, you can kill it, but sometimes you can set up with.
And one big question. Did you have any idea what he had for a secret card in his Warlock deck?
He had a secret card, a very secret tech card. Did you know about that?
No, like, maybe he had Sacrificial Pact or something like this, but yeah, like.
He did.
Yeah, like I can see, like many people play this, but.
Wow, you're not surprised. We were like overhyped. We didn't saw the card for half a year, and now you're saying,
Stansifka is a god. All right, well played, man. I wish you luck in your next series, as usual. May the cards.
I'm gonna play against Sally. I'm really hyped about it because, like, half a year ago, 2 years ago, we were battling the field of Magic the Gathering, and now we both switched to Hearthstone, and we are like top level in this game. So it's pretty much, you know, exciting, and like I'm gonna play him first time on the field of Hearthstone. So I'm really looking forward.
Is it the first time you faced off against him in a tournament setting?
I've played him several times in MTG, but I haven't played Hearthstone with him yet. So.
All right, well...
So I'm really pumped about it.
That's going to be pretty cool.
Yeah.
Yep. And again, congrats on the series. You were doing really well here, and now another top four. Really strong performance.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, have a nice one. So, guys, we're done with the second match. We're going to be moving on to the third one. Again, we're not done. We have a lot today. This is basically just the first portion of the round of eight. So we'll be taking a short break, and we'll come back with more matches. Stay tuned.